for several weeks we have been sharing to you what we call the spiritual blessings we found in Christ. And those spiritual blessings, we can read them in the book of Ephesians chapter 1. And also, if you have your Bibles with you, or if you don't have Bibles with you, or you have your e-Bibles, and as a matter of fact, these verses will also be flashed on the screen. Our text is found in Ephesians chapter 1, 13 to 14. It says here, Ephesians 1, 13 to 14, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit, guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise and glory, to the praise of his glory. Let's pray first. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that you have given to us to minister your word and to be ministered by your word, Lord. I pray, Father God, that by your Holy Spirit, you will teach us your word, O God, and let your word, Lord, strengthen us, transform us, and let your word, God, enlighten us and cause this message to draw us closer to you and to know you more, God, in our lives. Lord, I pray for each heart that by your Holy Spirit will be able to receive, understand, and apply your words, Lord, God, in our lives. We thank you, Father. This is our prayer, Lord, God, and we ask all this. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen and amen. So, the spiritual blessings in Christ, one of them is found in verses 3 and 4. You were, that before the creation of the world, you were chosen to be holy. Verses 4 and 6, you were predestined to be his sons and daughters. It happened before the creation of the world. So before the creation of the world, God had predestined you to become his sons and daughters. And also you were redeemed by his blood. These are all powerful blessings we received when we accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior. You have known the mysteries of God. You have hope in Christ. And the thought that I'm going to share to you today is you were marked with a seal. I'll be sharing to you three thoughts from this passage. The first one is the importance of proclaiming the gospel. And the second one is the effect of believing. And the third one is the work of the Holy Spirit in the inside of us. So let's go to the importance of proclaiming the gospel. It says here in verse 13, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth. You were included in Christ. The word included in Christ. In some passages it says here, in him, or believe. These phrases or process or words has similar meaning. If you're in Christ, it talks about our salvation. It talks about our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. When you were included in Christ, when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, when you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. Verse 13 says, you were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth. How were you able to hear the message of truth? Paul also called this message of truth the gospel of salvation. The message of the gospel of salvation is the same. When you heard the message of truth, somebody came to you to share the gospel. Somebody was used by God to come to you to share, to minister the word of God. Somebody to tell someone that the message of truth. How did you become a Christian? Because somebody invited you to the church, or somebody, or maybe your friend, shared to you his faith, his relationship with Jesus. How did you become a Christian? In one of our Bible studies, I asked everybody how they became Christians. Each one has a story to tell. In one of our Bible studies, Mr. Joy, Brother Andy's pastor, Mr. Javi's Brother Paul. And then each one of them, they have, they're excited to tell how they came to know the Lord. Basically, it came from, for example, Sister Joy, a church was pioneered in their barrio in Iloilo, and they were invited to come to the church. And then it all started that way. And then she became Christian. Sister Javi naman, in Baguio, she was also invited para meron isang parang DBS or some Bible studies for kids, and she was invited to come to this gathering, and it all started there. So how were you able to know the Lord? Because somebody come to you and witness to you his faith. Somebody has to tell someone the message of truth. Romans chapter 10, 9-15. Okay, Romans 10:9-15. It says here, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your mouth that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. So somebody has to tell someone the message of truth. When was the last time that you really share your faith to somebody? When every time you eat your lunch in your office, when was the last time that you really shared your faith to the person? When you are working in the shop, when was the last time that you shared your faith to the person beside you? When it comes to your family members, when was the last time that you really shared your faith to that person, to your brother or to your sister? Somebody has to tell someone the message of truth. You came to know the Lord because somebody was used by God to share the good news. Verse 13 says again, as you were also included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal. When my dad was still alive, he used to tell me a story of a certain man named, pangalan si Mr. Taplak. Every time we go to sleep, he would tell me a lot of stories hanggang sa nakatulog na ako. He would always tell me this man named Mr. Taplak. And this man, every time they go to the mountain to get firewood, would always tell him stories about the Bible. And that time he was not yet a Christian. It all started in that conversation. And then it made my father aware of his need of a Savior, because somebody shared to him the gospel. And my father became a Christian, and he shared the good news to my mother. Both of them became Christians. He shared the gospel to all their brothers, my mother's family. All of them also became Christian. And also the side of my father, all of them became Christian. Two of my mother's brothers became pastors, and my father's older brother became a pastor too. Tapos yung mga anak-anak pa nila, they're not, many of them are serving the Lord also in the ministry. Why would somebody share the gospel? Hindi siya naging spy, naging 007, tahimik lang, ito lang sinasabi. Somebody share the gospel. And also we are commanded to do so, to proclaim the gospel. In Mark 16:15-16, it says, here, he said to them, baptized to do the same. But whoever does not believe will be condemned. So this is a command. We call this the Great Commission. And this is our duty, our job as sons and daughters of God. I remember reading the book of Dr. Paul Yong-Kicho several years ago. I read his book titled The Fourth Dimension. He mentioned there how he came to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Yong-Hee Cho is the pastor of the largest church in the world, the Yoidukul Gospel Church in Seoul, Korea. Formerly, he was a Buddhist. And there came a time in his life that he was diagnosed to have incurable tuberculosis. He was in the hospital, and he would he would hear doctors talk about his health situation, and the doctor and hear the doctor, oh, this man is hopeless. He has only 6 months to live with his incurable tuberculosis. But one day, while he was lying on his bed in the hospital, a little girl came to him, sharing to him the gospel. A little girl shared to him the gospel. Because old Cho is a Buddhist, he doesn't want to change his religion. And he would curse this girl and ask him to go out of the room. And this girl would go out, and then the following day, this little girl will come again and share to him the gospel. Until one day he would shout again to this girl, cursing her. And this girl in front of, and Dr. Cho's heart melted because of this girl's perseverance, his passion to share his faith. The little girl said, "Okay, Cho, I'm going to go out of this room, but can I ask you a favor? I'm going to leave you a Bible. Can you just read this Bible?" Because Job was already impressed with the faith of the girl, he began to read the Bible. And he read in the Bible that Jesus healed the sick, he cast out demons. Every person who are in need of something, if they come to Jesus, their needs are being met. And Dr. Cho began to put his faith on the Lord Jesus Christ. He would always read his Bible. And later on, he asked Jesus to heal him of the incurable diseases. And he got healed. He got healed. And later on, of course, God called Dr. Cho into the ministry. And he started to pioneer the largest church in the world. That's in the Guinness Book of Records, World Book of Records. And why? Because somebody shared the gospel. Somebody made the decision to share the gospel. It is a command. We are to share the gospel. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Brother Andy also has a good testimony about how he came to know the Lord. It was he was formerly many times he can be seen on the streets shouting against voicing out his voicing out his desires for the government. He wants something, wants to change something. He was not a Christian, but his sister in the U.S. Shared with him the gospel, and Brother Andy became Christian. But my point here is, you don't know the person whom you're going to share the gospel. You don't know who will be the next young preacher, who will be the next Billy Graham. Billy Graham, he got saved when he responded to the altar call, and he was the only person who went to the altar to accept Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. But the point there is, somebody shared the good news. Amen. Are we still here? Okay. The message we are commanded to proclaim is good news. Bring it up in good news. The message we are commanded to proclaim is good news. It's not bad news. It's good news. If you have a good news with you, if you carry a good news with you, and that good news is for somebody else, you're excited to tell the good news to that person. Why? Because you are carrying with you a good news. You're excited. And because this is a command should be followed. Jesus, before he ascended to heaven, after he rose from the dead, he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. But whoever does not believe will be condemned. So it is a command given by Jesus to all his followers. Now, the word believe here is not just a mind thing. It's just a mind thing. Oh, I choose to believe. Okay, what are you trying to tell me? Okay, I believe that. No. To believe is more than just a mind thing. Because the Bible says that even the devil believes in God. So the devil is a theist. The devil is not an atheist. The devil is a theist. And when he believes, he shatters every time he hears about things about God. James 2:19 says, you believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shatter. The word believe here is a commitment of our whole being to know and follow Christ. Commitment of our whole being to know and follow Christ. There's a difference between knowing facts about Jesus Christ, and there's a difference between knowing facts about Jesus Christ and also experiencing Jesus Christ. You can know something about Christ that his dad is named Joseph the carpenter, his mother's name is Mary, and that he was born in a manger by his mom Mary, and he was born a virgin. It's something to know facts about Jesus, who Jesus is. You can even know, we study in scripture, that he was prophesied even in the Old Testament. But the knowledge here is not knowledge based on facts, but knowledge that is gained through experience. Knowledge gained through experience. It's not a head knowledge, but a heart knowledge. I think Pastor from Vancouver mentioned this also when he ministered the word of God here. That's the knowledge of God. That has to do with believing. The knowledge that based on facts, but it is gained through experience. That's why Christianity is not a religion, it is a relationship. It's a relationship with God. It's a relationship with Jesus. We don't study the Bible to increase our facts about what's happening in every character in the Bible. We study the Bible, that's why we meditate on it, to increase our relationship with Jesus, to know Him more in our lives, to experience Him more. That is experiential knowledge. Now, somebody has to tell someone the message of truth, and if that somebody believe and accept the gospel, what will be the effect? The effect of believing. The effect of believing is in verse, is in our text. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of His glory. The moment you believe, you were marked in Him with a seal. You were marked in Him with a seal. And that seal, as the scripture said, is the promised Holy Spirit. Ephesians was written by Paul when he's one of the Paul's prison epistles, meaning that this letter was written by Paul was while he was in prison. It was not really a prison, sinasabi ko na nasa kulungan siya, but it was somewhat like a house arrest. He can still be visited, he can still write letters and send it somewhere. Now, Ephesus was a leading commercial city in the whole Asia Minor during that time. Asia Minor is the modern-day Turkey. It's a leading city where businesses are active and ongoing. That, as a matter of fact, the city of Ephesus has its own port and business establishments, meaning the businesses here are very active. Now, in ancient time, a seal or signet was an instrument of a metal or stone with an engraved pattern or design on it. It would be pressed into a softer metal, usually moss or clay, leaving an imprint like a stamp. That's what seal is meant here. Now, when you are born again, when you believe, when you are included in Christ, when you are with Christ or in Christ, the moment you believed, you were marked with a seal. Tinatakan ka na agad. Now, what is the significance of that seal? What does that seal connote? First, the seal is a symbol of authenticity. In the Philippines, you can see fake DVDs around everywhere. You can see fake Louis Vuitton bags, lahat ng bags kung pakalan sa Green Hills, all kinds of fake bags are there. Gusto mo class 1, class 2, class 3, it's still fake, no? So ito, class 1 ko, maybe it's genuine leather, but it's still fake. You can see DVDs everywhere, especially in Quiapo, in Raccoon, in Cubao. You can see fake DVDs there. And this business is what kills those companies who are producing this, who are paying large amount of money to artists to produce their their DVDs. Now, how can one know that a product or a DVD is authentic or not? Sometimes I think they would put a seal into it, telling the buyers that this DVD is authentic. They would put a seal into it. So the seal is a symbol of authenticity. Our scripture says the Holy Spirit is the deposit guarding our inheritance until the redemption of of those who are God's possession. It's a symbol of authenticity. The Holy Spirit in us is the proof that we are truly God's redeemed sons and daughters. It's the Holy Spirit in us. So the seal is a symbol of authenticity. Number two, that seal is a symbol of ownership. Also, it's a symbol of ownership. Let me give you an example. When we transferred in our house in Millwoods, actually from 106th Street, we transferred to Millwoods. Wala kaming dalang furnitures. Kasi wala kaming, bago pa lang kami dito. We were just new immigrants during that time. So when we transferred to move our house, there's nothing there. So we find not so expensive furniture. So we visited one brick store to another. And in one of the brick store, we found there a table. And we approached the agent. Oh, this table is not expensive. Can we have this? Can we purchase this? The agent told us, sorry, sir. You can no longer purchase this table. You have you seen that seal there? It's already sold. Somebody already owned this. It's already sold. Somebody owned this table already. Already paid the price for this table. So a seal is a proof that the commodity was already purchased and owned by somebody. Seal signifies a finished transaction. You can no longer have it. Nobody can have it for itself because it's already sold. Already owned by somebody. When we believe God put His seal of ownership on us, we become His possession. The seal says that we are no longer owned by the world, we are no longer owned by Satan, we are now owned by Jesus, we are now owned by God. 2 Timothy 2, verse 19. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with His inscription. The Lord knows those who are His. And everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness. So when we believe, God put His seal of ownership on us. Nothing and no one can take us away from God. A seal is a symbol of ownership. And also God owns, because God owns us, He has authority over us. He owns us. We call Him as our Lord and our Savior. He's the Lord. His name is Jesus the Lord. And because God owns us, He has authority over us. We ought only to serve and worship Him and not the world or the devil. Our passions and desires now should be to fulfill the perfect plan of God in our lives. Why? Because God owns us. We no longer live to fulfill our own will, but we surrender that will to God and ask God, Lord, what is your will for my life? Because of God, you own me. I'm yours, Lord. What is your perfect will for me? Lord, your will to be your will, that I may fulfill it. A seal is a symbol of ownership. And the third one is, a seal signifies security. Security. We are bought at a price, and it took the blood of Jesus to buy us. It signifies security. If that commodity is already bought, commodity is already secured for somebody who bought it, for somebody who owns it. Ephesians 4, verse 30, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Do not grieve the Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. The Holy Spirit, with whom you were sealed. Though life in this world is tough most of the time, we are secured in Christ. Sometimes life is tough. Sometimes we are encountering problems, trials, challenges in life. Sometimes we are losing hope. Though life in this world is tough most of the time, we are secure in Christ. No one can snatch us from His hand. Seal signifies security. Trials, challenges that occur in our lives should not affect our relationship with God. Somebody made an illustration about what eternity is. How can you define eternity? Ang ginawa niya, to illustrate eternity, kumuha siya ng sobrang habang ubin. Sobrang habang ubin. A very long rope. Tapos, dun sa rope na yun, sobrang haba. Pero isang pulgada siguro, an inch na kulay red. Sabi niya. Imagine that this rope has no end. And this red, 1 inch red here, is your life. It's your life. Yan ang buhay mo. Maybe we won't get someone to it. Maybe that it would be 80 to 90 years. How? Compared to eternity, ano yan? Wala yung sinabi. So, there may be trials, challenges that may happen to us. It should not affect our relationship with God. That should not cause us to hide away from God. Because in Christ, you are secured. The more we face challenges in life, the more we should come to God. To ask for His favor, for His strength, for His mercy, for His grace. Seal signifies security. Now, in verses 13 to 14 in our text, it says here that the Holy Spirit Himself is the seal that is marked on us. It's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the deposit guaranteeing our inheritance. Now, what is a deposit? A deposit is an earnest money given to other parties as proof of intention to purchase the product or property. Yung deposit, sabi sa first sa text natin, di ba? And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Yeah. You were marked in Him with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of His glory. So the deposit there means earnest money. I remember one day when we want to rent a certain building. I talked to the owner of the building. I told her that, ma'am, we want to hire your property, this building. And the owner of the building said, are you really interested to hire this building? So I go, yes, ma'am. Okay, you need to give me a deposit. You need to give me an earnest money. So that showing to me your intention to really rent our property. Because if you don't give me the earnest money, it means that you're not that interested. Because I need the earnest money, because maybe after this transaction with you, somebody would pay the rent in full. So the Holy Spirit is the deposit guaranteeing our inheritance. It's in us. when you got born again, when you believed, when you were included in Christ, you were marked with the Holy Spirit. That's why the Bible says that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own, you were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies, so you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit resides in you. In Romans 8, verse 11, and if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you. So the Spirit who raised Christ from the dead is also the Spirit who is dwelling, who is residing on each and every one of you when you believe, because God sealed you with His Spirit. Nakatatak na sa'yo, Banal Espiritu. And who is the Holy Spirit? Because the Holy Spirit is the God Himself. The Holy Spirit is the third person of the Blessed Trinity. God Himself dwells in us. Now, what that this means? God resides in you. The Holy Spirit is in you. He's dwelling in you wherever you go. He is with you. I remember Dr. Joe made an illustration about God's address. Sabi niya, do you know God's address? Do you know where God lives? God's address is your address. Because wherever you are, God lives there. Because God lives and dwells in you. So your address is God's address. The point there is, because the Holy Spirit dwells in us, He is with us wherever we go. So, now my point is, because God is with you, God is in you, let the Holy Spirit be the source of your strength. Let Him be your teacher, your guide. John 14, verse 26, but the Advocate, or the Counselor, in other translations, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Let Him be your teacher, your guide. Sometimes we feel that God is far, far away. Lord, asan ka ba? Lord, nandito ako. Why am I experiencing these troubles? Lord, where are you? Sometimes we feel that way, and of course, we should recognize that God knows your situation, and God is just a prayer away. Let the Holy Spirit be the source of your strength. Let Him be your teacher and your guide. We should learn how to commune with Him. We should learn how to commune with the Holy Spirit. Commune means fellowship. And let His strength flow through us. Because sometimes it's not really our strength, by might or by power, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. We need His strength. We need His strength. You are sealed with the Holy Spirit. Learn to commune with Him. There is such a thing as fellowshipping with the Holy Spirit, or communion with the Holy Spirit. We talk to Jesus, we pray to the Father, but sometimes we neglect the Holy Spirit. We also need to commune and talk and fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Philippians 2, verse 1, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit. Fellowship here means communion. Communion. Christianity is not knowing facts about God. Christianity is an experiential knowledge of God. Experiencing His presence every day of our lives. Sometimes we are too busy doing things of the world, Gising tayo ng umaga ng mapadali po sa trabaho. Uwi ng bahay, pagod na. Tulog. Pag may kwentuhan, may parang kung may presente, kung kay Pato, kung kay artista sa teleserye. And our minds are far from God. From all this business of life, we need to pause a little bit sometimes and commune and fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Pag sa bahay, forma ka na sa EFC, teleserye. Ano na nangyari kay we should also give time to the business of our lives. Busy tayo ng isang tarang. Busy, iba din sa Canada. Iba rin. Parang walang pahinga. But it's also good sometimes that we need to pause. We need to slow down and pause for a moment and say, hello, Holy Spirit, I want to come in with you. Lord, create in me again a thirst and hunger for you. I want to fellowship with you. Jesus, I want to know you more in my life. So the Holy Spirit is there right beside you. And sometimes di natin siya pinapansin. Di natin pinapansin ang Holy Spirit. Kasi busy-busy tayo. Ikaw ba naman, kaibigan mo, di ka pinapansin. Di ka pinapansin. Dahil ang utak niya sa iba, ginagawa niya iba. Kakasama mo siya dito. Hindi mo siya pinapansin. Paano maramdaman ang kaibigan mo? Masasaktan siya. Well, don't you know that the Holy Spirit is also sensitive? He's sensitive. He wants... the Holy Spirit wants you to commune with Him. Kaya ang dami sabi ng do not grieve. Diba? Because even may illusion of the Holy Spirit. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 4:20. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God with whom you were sealed. You were sealed. Do not grieve Him. And Ephesians 2:1 says, if it talks about fellowship and communion with the Holy Spirit, communion with Him, with the Holy Spirit. He's with you. He's in us. He's in us. He's with us. He dwells in us. You are sealed with the Holy Spirit. Let Him be your strength, your guide. Every time you do something, Holy Spirit, please help me. Which way am I going to be communed with the Holy Spirit? Paul and call the Holy Spirit his senior partner. Everything that he does, he will always consult the Holy Spirit. He knows the way of fellowship with Him. So, like us, brothers and sisters, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit resides in you. Wherever you go, the Holy Spirit is there. That's hindi mo naman. Huwag mo naman siyang isinabi. Huwag mo naman siyang isinabi. Learn to commune with Him and fellowship with Him. Did everybody say it? Amen. That's right. That's right. And as I call on, as I pray, I want the worship team to come and lead us in some worship songs. Lord, we just thank you, God, for all these spiritual gifts you have given to us, Lord. And it's all by your mercy and by your grace. It's not because of what we have done, but because of your grace and mercy to us, because of your love, Lord God. Lord, thank you for the Holy Spirit who is dwelling in our hearts, in the inside of us. Lord, I pray that he would create again the hunger and thirst in our hearts, to desire more of you, to fellowship with the Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, and we bless you, Lord God. This is our prayer, and that's all this. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.